especially when Piazza got busted and they needed some help. Anyway, it's all in Citizen Spy, but I had no idea, Rob, where I was going with this. The mob started talking to me about building a film studio for me in Panama under the Panamanian dictator Omar Torrijos. And they were going to do that so I would make my films down there. But then they would purchase the film for $1 for the print to bring into the United States. That way they don't pay taxes. And then, yeah, oh, they're smart people, very intelligent. Then they would release the films here, and, of course, all the profit is in their pocket. So anyway, I got in there, and the more I learned, and the more I learned. And the way I got involved with this whole thing was they said that somebody was selling drugs on my kid's schoolyard. Well, I did what I think every parent should do. You know, you call the cops, and they say, well, you know, we have too much on our plate. Baloney.
Yeah.
They don't seem to understand. They work for us, you know. And so I did what they couldn't, or shall we say, wouldn't do. And I think every parent should tell the police, you work for me. You don't tell me what to do. You follow the law. You do it. And if they don't do it, get a new police commissioner, because that's who you vote for.
Doesn't it say on the side of police cars to serve and protect?
Exactly. Serve and protect. They act like they're the Gestapo sometimes. They're not in charge. We are. You know, so long as we're following the law, of course,
exactly.
Naturally.
Exactly. So, Robert, with reference to the money laundering aspect in the Vatican, because you outline it in your book, and you know, you make ties to organized crime, and the Vatican's all, this is the second scandal to rock the Vatican in as many weeks, because now the people are going to be putting the Pope under the microscope. Because he apparently knew of the, how can I be politically correct with this one? The abuse children were suffering at the hands of members of clergy.
Yes, yes. But I must say, now I'm going to slightly defend the Pope, because I don't know what he did or what he didn't know. Because if he did know about the money laundering, that's one thing.
Right.
More than likely, he didn't, because the president of the bank is usually an archbishop. And when I went after him, it was Archbishop Marcinkus, Paul Marcinkus, and he originated out of Cicero, Illinois. And Cicero, Illinois in the United States was at that time a hotbed of mafia. And he was slid into it. They bought his position in there, and he had a very slick way of doing it, and the Pope themselves had no way of knowing. However, Pope John Paul I, the Pope of 30 days, he was a lot smarter than what they ever expected. When he ascended, he demanded the books from the Vatican Bank and also Banco Ambrosiano, which was another bank owned by the Vatican. And he kept demanding and demanding and demanding, and they knew what he was going to do. Finally, the books were delivered to his chambers, and before midnight, he was dead. And they said, of course, it was a heart attack.
Of course.
And he was buried without an autopsy. So the popes themselves may or may not know. So I'm not too sure. I would accuse him until I find out where all the chips lie. But either way, they should have learned their lesson by that time. But when after Marcinkus was... he holed up in the Vatican for, oh, God, several years, and the FBI was always waiting. He never could step foot off the Vatican grounds. And finally, they got all the information they needed. They allowed him to come back to the United States. That was the deal. He would testify, and he would be allowed to come back to the United States still in his frock or whatever you call it. They didn't kick him out. They brought him back. And he went into retirement, obviously.
Sure.
And of all places, he ended up living in retirement within 30 miles of Joseph Bonanno, the cop of the Tutti Gatti in the United States. And when he died, he's buried not very far away from his mentor.
Something that we found was very interesting, Robert, when we started doing research for your interview today, was that in the 1980s, the bank The Vatican Bank also made headlines over its involvement in one of Italy's biggest fraud cases, the collapse of Milan Banco Ambrosio that you mentioned, which lent more than $1 billion to companies in Central America that existed mostly on paper.
Yes, yes. And the interesting thing, I got corrected the other day. Because I claimed $500 million in my book, because that's what I knew about.
Yeah.
My FBI pal, who is now retired, and he also operates new investigative services, he corrected me later. He said, you know, he says, I got in touch with some friends of mine, and he said, it was over $1 billion, Bobby.
Wow.
I said, you're kidding. And 2 days later, he called me. He said, my God, he said, an old friend of mine from the State Department, he said, Morgan, listen to this. It's not $500 million. It's not $1 billion. It's billions, plural. So my little book, I mislead people. They think $500 million is a lot. Well, it was billions, plural. And I just learned that 2 days ago.
When we're talking about the Vatican Bank, even 100,000 or even 200,000 or even 50,000, that's a lot of money, because it's my understanding, Rob, that all the money that the Vatican Bank holds is used to help around the world.
Supposedly.
And I know for a fact, Robert, that the Vatican is the world's richest corporation. Because when you look at it in the world of finance, the Pope is the CEO, the Cardinals are the board of directors, and everyone below that are shareholders.
That's right. Yes, and you know, the American people, I think of all the people, the poor people, who tithe consistently to a church, wanting to show God how much they respect and how much they help them, and they're being ripped off. They're being lied to. Any church that can do things like this, how can they ever represent a true loving God? It's impossible.
And coming from you, I know that you're into Zen, and you're just a person who believes that, you know, do unto others.
Well, what you are is the way I look at it. What I am now is what I have learned to be in previous times. What I will become is what I do with what I have now.
Robert, stand by, buddy. We've got to take our break with the news. Exxon Nation, Robert W. Morgan is our special guest. Robert, give the Exxon Nation your website.
Oh, www.robertwmorgan, all one word, robertwmorgan-alive.com.
There you go, www.robertwmorgan-alive.com. Robert W. and I will be back on the other side of this commercial break with the news. As the Exxon continues with yours truly, Rob McConnell, on the other side of this break from our studios in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. Don't go away.
What would you ask if you had just one question?
Are you considering calling a psychic to read your situation? Then consider David Champion, a psychic medium for more than 20 years with thousands of readings under his belt. David Champion will make you feel comfortable. He has proven to be honest and accurate. He's a straight shooter. There's no guesswork. What he sees is what you get. While he is a medium, most of the calls focus on relationships, not only love, but work, school, neighbors, and more. Need help with finding a job and preparing for the interview? Are you dealing with people who are obstacles in your path? For more information, go to davidchampion.com, $1.50 per minute, paid by credit card, with a minimum of 30 minutes. For your reading with David Champion, call 1-877-702-8598. That's 1-877-702-8598.
Nine, eight.
Now you can dial in to listen to the X-Zone Radio Show from anywhere in the world with Rob McConnell 24/7, 365 by dialing 213-401-0080. That's 213-401-0080. If you have a mobile phone or landline, the X-Zone Radio Show with Rob McConnell is now at your beck and call at 213-401-0080. That's 213-401-0080, 24/7, 365.
You're listening to the X-Zone Radio Show, live and around the world on the Talkstar Radio Network.
X-Zone Broadcast Network.
UK High Definition Radio.
Euro High Definition Radio.
And Star Cable. Our toll-free telephone number worldwide is 1-800-610-7035.
Our email address, xzone@xzoneradiotv.com.
On MSN Messenger, xzoneradiotv@hotmail.com.
And our website,
www.xzoneradiotv.com.
Why do I feel like I'm losing control?
Exonation, if you missed my interview with Robert W. Morgan on Monday, September the 13th, all you have to do is go to exonepodcast.com and go down to Monday, September the 13th and click on the on Robert's line that we have. You can either listen to it on our RSS feed or you can download it through our Apple iPod. And by the way, Apple iTunes. And by the way, as of this past Wednesday, we've had over 500,000 downloads this year, and according to somebody I spoke to at Apple, they told me for every one download that comes down, two other people listen to that download, and there's no way of tracking how many downloads are passed from friend to friend to friend to friend. So a proper estimate of downloads, 1.5 million. It's not too bad for 1 year's work. And it's because of people like my guest this hour, Robert W. Morgan. We're talking about Robert's new book, Citizen Spy, Vatican Cover-Up, The Mob, Money Laundering and Murder. His website is www.robertwmorgan-live.com, and his book's available at Borders. Robert, how has the local media been treating your story and your success and the... and your book, Citizen Spy, and the way you're blowing the cover off of something that many people believe should never be touched?
I don't know why. Truth is truth. As a matter of fact, the Daily Interlake newspaper in Kalispell, Montana, spells with a K, hit the front page, photograph and all. And I have to tell anybody that downloads it, I did what the photographer asked me to do. So I kept trying to smile. She said, "This is not a funny subject." Mm-hmm. Oh. Anyway, it's been plastered all over the place. I go down to my favorite place for a beer or two. My God, they've got it on the freaking wall.
Wow.
So I'm getting all kinds of... up here in Montana, the people are so sweet and so nice and kind. Mm-hmm. And I had one detractor, he made a comment at a bar. He says, "Here comes the snitch." I thought they were going to kill him. They explained to him by Braille that a snitch is someone that snitches on their own to their own benefit. I was an agent. I was involved. I did my job. Mm-hmm. And I'm very proud of what I did. So So there's no snitching involved. This is going in. This is called intelligence and counterintelligence is what it goes down to. But anyways, there are people like that. What are you going to do? You know, God bless them. Good luck to them.
During World War II and during World War I and other conflicts around the world, when citizens help out, it's called resistance. Why is it when anyone, a citizen, joins law enforcement to counteract organized crime, which is a war, they're frowned upon?
I think that perhaps, this is just my opinion, I think it's because when they look inside themselves, they realize they could have done the same damn thing, but they didn't have the guts. And so they strike out at those who did. And,